For my presentation, this is the title I've given it based on what emails we've sent around, is Integrating Humanism in Business Education, a workshop. So this is a workshop. In my mind, we're going to be sitting around in a circle and we'd be talking. So we're happy to be talking here too. So feel free to interrupt me whenever you want to, if you want me to clarify something or talk more about something, or just ask questions. I'm very happy to do that. So what I'm thinking is, the workshop may have four parts. It may only have one part. We might get stuck here, or we might get stuck here. We don't have to do all of those things. I'd like to spend a little bit of time on here, though, for sure. But if we get through it all, that's great, and if we don't, that's fine with me too. This is your time for you to ask me questions if you want to, or for us to dialogue about stuff. So here's the four parts that I'm suggesting we look at. First, I'm going to give you an overarching conceptual framework that guides my teaching and research. So I've read your mission statements, and I've read some of the documents that Max and Ole have sent to me. I'm very impressed, and it resonates with me. Because that's how I look at the world too, basically. So I look at it a bit differently, so that's why I want to put up my conceptual framework, and maybe that will help you not only when you're thinking about your teaching, but also when you're thinking about your research and provide you a structure with that. Because my understanding is you're supposed to be doing research that somehow gets Catholic social thought into the business disciplines. So that's the first part that I want to look at. Then, I'm happy to spend time looking at how you integrate humanism into specific business disciplines. So I've got management, accounting, finance, and marketing. We don't have to do them all. We can spend all our time on one or the other. I don't know. How many of you are Matt? Yes?
Excuse me. Sorry for interruption, Bruno. Are we going to have a copy of this presentation somehow?
If you want to, I can give you a copy of the overhead slide.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. How many of you are teaching in management area? How many of you are teaching in accounting, finance, and marketing? So we're all represented here, so we can look at all of them as long or as short as you want. That's the point there. Then, this is some research I'm working on now. How do we teach and the importance of praxis when we teach? So in universities, this is a very intellectual place, and we usually think of, well, if we get the right ideas, if we get the right knowledge to the students, then the students will go and act on that knowledge. And the research that I've been reading and working on suggests it's important for us to get students to practice that knowledge before they actually own it, before they actually change and changes their behavior. So we'll talk a little bit about that. And then if we have time, I can talk to you a little bit about where my own research is going in the future. Maybe that can inspire you too about what you're thinking about your teaching or your research. So that's the overview. Does that sound good? Or any questions about that before we continue? Or do you want to change the order of something? Yes?
What about taxes? Have you been thinking about taxes as well as management, accounting, or you?
Taxes?
Yeah. The humanism, yeah.
I don't have specific thoughts about taxes, but when we go into accounting, or if you want to ask, maybe during finance, we can talk about that. I'm happy to do that.
I would have to know about your thinking about this.
Yeah, I haven't done any research or deep thinking about taxes.
Maybe you can help us.
Okay, good. So when we get to that part, let's open that door again if you want to talk about that. Good, thank you. Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't know this was going to be a big room. Can you read this? It says mainstream management. This is formally rational knowledge. So when we're teaching our curriculum of accounting and finance and marketing, we have formally rational knowledge. Its emphasis is on materialism and individualism. So the M-A-I-N is in mainstream. Sort of clever, isn't it? So mainstream management is rational. It's based on materialism and individualism. It's all about productivity, efficiency, maximizing profits. It's all about the owners, self-interested, self-interest with guile in some of the economic theory. So that's what mainstream management is about. And that's what our textbooks teach. Mainstream management is based on, I like the language of a moral point of view.
Your documents talk about epistemology and assumptions about anthropology and those kinds of things. That's sort of bundled up into here. It's based on certain values. So Weber talks about formal rationality, and he talks about substantive rationality. And this is the deeper rationality. These are the values that we have built our whole business curriculum on. And for Weber, it started off with the Protestant ethic. And he talks about living in an iron cage. The iron cage metaphor is maybe the most popular, the most powerful metaphor in the social sciences, in the scholarly literature. We live in a materialist, individualist iron cage that made sense to the Protestants, whatever, 300 years ago, but now it's been secularized and we all do it. We all say we need to get ahead, we need to be productive, we need to be efficient, we need more money, and it's all about me, and if I can get more money at a different job, I'll go to a different job. So that's sort of normal, that's been secularized. It's under the moral philosophy that I've argued it's under is consequential utilitarianism. So it's all about consequences. We're looking at the outcomes. How much did you earn? How many things did you produce? How many sales did you make? And it's utilitarian in the sense that it's all about money. So money is a proxy for everything. If I want to pay my, if I'm a worker and I get a salary, I can do with that money what I want to. I can go on trips if I want to. I can buy books if I want to. I can donate it to charity if I want to. But the money is the utility that allows us to make this whole system work. So it's all about money in that sense. And I'm arguing it's a hollow philosophical anthropology. It's really good at what it does. Humankind is wealthier than ever before in terms of the stuff that we've amassed. But are we happier as a species? Are we happier as humankind? And the example that I have here is from a study that looked at business students going into Harvard Business School. And they were given a list of 20 virtues and said, which of these virtues are your personal virtues? Rank them. What's the most important virtue and the least important virtue? And they had the virtue of compassion. And compassion, I think, was number 3 on the list. Compassion is important to me as a person. And then they said, okay, now you're going to business school, now rank those, how would you rank these virtues for the business school? And compassion was, I think, number 19 out of 20. So we have our own personal values that's our character, that's who we want to become, and that's who we see ourselves or want to see ourselves as, what we think is important. But once we enter the business school, we have to strip that away and say it's not about compassion anymore, it's not about love, it's about profits, it's about getting ahead, it's whatever the other virtues were. So that's the mainstream paradigm. There's problems with this paradigm. The article of the decade in the Academy of Management Review talked about self-fulfilling prophecies built into our theories. And it says, if we are teaching theories that are based on materialism and individualism, we will become more materialistic and more individualistic. And the research shows that business students become more materialistic and more individualistic as they go through their programs of study. It shows that we as business professors are more materialistic and individualistic than the sociology and the other professors on campus. Because that's what we're teaching, that's what we're breathing, that's what the mainstream paradigm is. The growth of this mainstream paradigm has also coincided with the growth of social problems, so the widening gap between rich and poor that's within organizations for the last 40 years, it's been widening. Within countries, it's been widening, and between countries, it's been widening. And it makes sense from this paradigm. Everybody's self-interested, and if you have more power, you can widen that gap. Ecological problems like climate change. The world's 3,000 largest multinational corporations account for $2 trillion of negative ecological externalities every year. That's about 7% of their revenues are negative ecological externalities. So if they're making 7% profit, it's not 7% profit, it's all the stuff that they're, all the pollution, all the things that they're throwing into the atmosphere and into the ground and into the waters. It's about 4% of the global GDP. There's ecological problems because we have externalities, and we'll talk about that. We'll talk about how this says, here's your business and here's the outside. We don't really care about the outside. In fact, if we can pollute on the outside, it saves us money. That's a good thing. We're good managers. That's inherent in that kind of a model. And the third I'm going to talk about, or call it spiritual problems, a lack of meaning. This is not giving us much meaning in terms of who we are as humans. We're not treating people with dignity if we do that. It's not concerned for the common good. It's concerned about the self, and it's concerned about stuff. So what do we need? We need something that I call multi-stream management. And here's a book that I'm going to hand around, so if you get bored listening to me, there's pictures in here. When we wrote this book, we took the top five selling management textbooks and said anything that's in at least three of those five textbooks, we will put into that book, and we will call it mainstream management. Each chapter has mainstream management and multi-stream management. So you have, what does strategy look like from here or here? Motivation, goal setting, leadership, controlling, all of them. Each chapter has two streams. So when my students are taking my course and they're reading that book, they're reading about two kinds of goal setting, mainstream goal setting and multi-stream goal setting. Multi-stream management is also formally rational knowledge. And that's important. It's not just that these guys are formally rational. These guys are formally rational based on this moral point of view. Multi-stream is formally rational based on an alternative moral point of view. So when I'm teaching my students, I'm teaching them two formal rationalities. And they're not used to thinking like that. This is an emphasis on multiple forms of well-being and multiple stakeholders. That's why it's multi-stream management. Also play on words. Multiple forms of well-being. So financial well-being is important, but so is social well-being, ecological well-being, physical well-being, spiritual well-being, aesthetic well-being. There's a lot of well-beings that are important. It's not just all about money. And there's multiple stakeholders. The owners are important, but so are employees, so are customers, so are suppliers, so are competitors, so are our neighbors, so are future generations. What does management look like if you have that kind of a moral point of view guiding it? So here, it's again a different substantive rationality, again using Weber's language. I argue that's a substantive rationality that's consistent with Catholic social thought, which you guys are big into. In the textbook, I talk about it in terms of virtue theory. What would management look like if we were basing it on virtue theory? And one of the hallmarks of virtue theory is that virtues create happiness, eudaimonia, in community. That's a lot like businesses to me. A lot like an organization. It's not something that happens alone, it happens in a group. How do we search for happiness? It's not something I can do on my own. It's something that I need to do by practicing virtues in community. So we look at the four cardinal virtues and build that there. It has three dimensions of spirituality. So I don't know how you guys define spirituality. One of my favorite definitions has these three components, and it's big in continental Europe apparently. And it also has the most empirical support. So to be spiritual means for me to be connected to other people. And that's where the dignity and common good kinds of ideas come in. To be spiritual means to be connected to nature. And that's where our common home comes in, that kind of thinking. And to be spiritual means to be connected to the sacred. And I've done some research on that in terms of what that means and we can get into, but I won't right now. And it's the sacred for Christians might mean God. For non-Christians or for non-believers, there's something else that's sacred too. So the sacred is bigger than just an idea, a theistic idea from the literature's point of view. So this framework has guided a lot of my research and thinking. And if it looks helpful for you, then please borrow it or use it. That's good for me. At the end of the year, I've always asked students, we go through the whole book, well, where are you in a mainstream, multi-stream continuum? And those are sort of like ideal types for me. It's just like, that's Weberian language. You're an introvert or you're an extrovert. Well, nobody's a pure introvert and nobody's a pure extrovert. You're always along a continuum there. From an ideal type perspective, nobody's pure mainstream and nobody's pure multi-stream, but you're along a continuum somewhere. So students throughout the term are asking themselves, where am I? Who am I? And it's not just up here, and it's down here. What is my moral point of view? Who do I want to become? Kinds of questions. And at the end of the year, one of the things that gives me goosebumps is when a student comes to me and says, Bruno, I'm not mainstream and I'm not multi-stream, I'm my stream. And that means they figured out who they are. What are the values that, what's my moral point of view? Who am I as a moral being? And how will I enact that as a manager? So by giving them this infrastructure, I'm giving them the ability to think deeply about who they are and who they want to become and what kind of manager they want to become. And it makes me very happy. So this is the framework that underlines the textbook. I've also been fortunate to publish it in some, well, leading journals. I guess the Journal of Management Studies is a leading European management journal, Journal of Business Ethics, Management Decision. We just had a recent one on the goal setting stuff, Business and Society Review, Organization, Journal of Education for Business, and Journal of Catholic Higher Education and others. So this basic framework has served me well in my publishing career. It's given me the opportunity to say things that I think need to be said. Any questions on that before I continue? Yep.
Yeah, my question is, are we going to be accused of being dogmatic if we try to integrate Christianity on business training or education?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and I'll come to that, but I'll say right now already, at the end of the year, I don't say this is a Christian view, I say this is a virtue theory point of view. But in this context, I think it would be appropriate for you to say this is consistent with Catholic social thought. But at the end of the year, I ask my students and I say, I'm training you to be moral agents. You are now thinking about management as a moral discipline, as a moral endeavor. But I also want to be a moral instructor. Am I crossing the line by teaching you these two ways? Because I know that if I teach you these two ways, you're going to become more mainstream and more multi-stream. I mean, less mainstream and less multi-stream. I'm playing with your values. By teaching you this, you're going to become less multi-stream and less mainstream. Is that okay for me to do that? Or should I do like everybody else who just teaches this? But if I teach you just this, you're going to become more mainstream, materialistic and more individualistic. Here you're going to become less materialistic and less individualistic. Here you're going to become more. What error? Should I just teach you this? It's probably simpler. You as students only have to learn one thing. Here now you have to learn two things. What do you think I should do? And my students, I think 95% say, keep teaching both, Bruno. So they don't see that as a dogmatic, I'm saying this is the right way. And when I teach, I'm quite careful. At the end of the course, students often ask me, well, Bruno, what do you believe? Are you mainstream or are you multi-stream? So they ask me that question. I try to be even-handed, but the research shows that they become more or less materialistic and less individualistic as they learn that. Yep.
From a human perspective, I do believe that, multi-stream management is going to make more happy people, right? But from the economic perspective, you believe that multi-stream management is more profitable than mainstream management. So if you are able to demonstrate that multi-stream is more profitable, it can be a good tool for students that are going in the good way. If you are individual, you're going in the wrong way. No.
So that's a debate that's in the literature, and it's a debate that I have with my co-author. And lots of people are trying to say, you can have your cake and eat it too. This will make people happier and it'll make you more money because you're going to be more motivated and customers are going to seek you out and all of those things. I've never made that argument very strongly anyways, because once you make that argument, then this becomes co-opted to that. And that's what's happened with the corporate social responsibility literature. That's what happened with the stakeholder literature. Oh, we should be good to stakeholders because it'll actually make us more money. We should be corporate socially responsible because it'll actually make us more money. And once you slide it under that category, then there's a lot of things that you can't do anymore that are wholesome, holistic, dignifying, common good enhancing kinds of things. So maybe this is more profitable, maybe it isn't. For me, that's not the argument. The argument is, this is gonna make you happier. And I ask my students questions. I say, would you rather take a job for $75,000 that's in a very mainstream kind of a company where it's top-down control, or would you rather take a job for $60,000 that's more multi-stream where you have more say? And when they answer that question individually, nobody else seeing them, then most of them opt for this. Now, this is the kind of workplace, I'm willing to make less money, I'm willing to do that. But if you do it in public, and you have to raise your hands, then they vote for that, because what are my other MBA students gonna think if I say I want this? That kind of an argument. So this is what it looks like in my textbook in chapter one. So basically I say, here's relative emphasis on individualism, relative emphasis on materialism, mainstream is high on both, and multi-stream is relatively low on both. And I remember the first time I showed that to my MBA class, about a third of the students went, "Oh, you mean I don't have to be all about money? I can be an MBA student and not just be all about money?" It was a relief, they were thrilled. And about one third of them went, "How dare you? Who let this guy in the class anyway? We know it's all about mainstream." There's a pent up demand for this sort of stuff. Actually, the very first time I wrote the book, my first draft, I had all four cells. I said, here's voluntary simplicity, it's a different moral point of view, and here's participative approach, a different moral point of view. This is based on distributive justice ethics, on moral rights view, consequential utilitarianism, and virtue theory. But then people said, Bruno, two is enough for now, and I said, okay, that's fine. But I do ask my students, and I'll ask you, which is the best moral point of view for the study and practice of management? So in my textbook, I have this section here that says, do unto others as others would do unto you, as you would want others to do unto you. And there's Buddhism, Christianity, Confucianism, Hinduism, all those religions have that. So we all agree on this. Why can't we, why doesn't that translate into a common ethic? Well, it's partly because, how do I want to be treated? Do I want to be treated as though this is a mainstream world and it's about me working harder and making more money and then I'm going to win and that's how I'm going to treat other people, treat others as I want to be treated? So am I going to be in a consequential utilitarianism mode or in a virtue theory mode where it's all about the process and how we make decisions and developing character and working together? Or it's all about individual freedom. Everybody should be free to do what they want. It's all about the fair or just distribution of resources. So I ask my students, what's the best way of doing it? How do you want to be treated in the workplace? What kind of management theory makes sense to you? And they say, 7% say mainstream. This is what we're teaching them, right? They're not interested in that. 42% say multi-stream. 11% here and 39% there. So we're spending 95% or 80% of our time in the classroom teaching them this stuff, and that's not what the students want. It's not good for the environment. It's not good for society. It's not good for the person, but that's what we're doing. Sort of sad, isn't it? Okay, so we did some research. So in my school, we have, I think, 13 different classes that teach management in a year. So we looked at a number of the sections where they teach from my textbook, the mainstream and multi-stream, and a number of the classes where they just use a regular textbook. And what we found that students who learn two approaches have reduced materialism and individualism scores. They have higher critical thinking scores. So I don't know if you looked at the critical thinking literature, but a university is supposed to enhance critical thinking. That's an important thing that universities do. But when you look at the literature, a lot of people who have tried to measure critical thinking say, even after 4 years, it's hard to discern a difference from the students coming in to graduating. They haven't really improved their critical thinking very much. Studies that compare business students to other students say business students have lower critical thinking scores than other students. And there's two dimensions to critical thinking. One is a technical dimension, and business students do very well on this. This is logical, linear, orderly thinking. If this happens, and this happens, and this happens, business students are great at that. But it's the philosophical dimension that business students are weak on, the thinking outside the box. All we teach them is mainstream. We don't expose them to these others, right? So once you expose them to the others, all of a sudden they have higher critical thinking scores. Within one course, 3 months, you can increase your students' critical thinking. Yeah, this is what I said before. 95% said, teach me both ways. That's the more ethical way to be taught. 76% recommended their friends to choose a course that teaches two approaches to management as opposed to one. So even though it's more work, or it's maybe perceived to be more work, it's more rewarding for the student. And that's what they want for their friends also. And they say, they've become more multi-stream during the course, and they say in their career they want to be even more multi-stream. So they're going in that direction. And for me, that's the important thing. When I show them that continuum, I say, it doesn't really matter where you are, it matters which direction you're heading in. That's what you, as moral beings, need to decide. And they want to become more multi-stream. So how do you put this into practice? Which brings us to the part two of the workshop. But I'll pause here a bit more if you have any questions on the basic setup for what I do. Okay. Interrupt me anytime you want. This is good. So, Catholic social thought and the four functions of management. So when you look in any management textbook, or 98% of management textbooks are organized according to the planning, organizing, leading, and controlling, the four functions of management. That's Henri Fayol who put it up that way. And I'm just giving you a bit of an overview here, what it looks like. Yes?
Sorry, question. With regards to the previous slide, sorry. When teaching between mainstream and multi-stream, here in Spain we are very focused on whether Catholics or non-Catholics, right? Mm-hmm. But you find problems between different religions when focusing on multi-stream?
I would say, no. I don't see anything like that. I don't think anything is there along those lines. Often in the beginning of the year, I ask the questions. I mean, the textbook has many of the chapters have a reference to religion or to spirituality, and I ask the students, "Would you want me to talk about that in class, or you don't feel quite comfortable with that?" And they almost always say, "We don't feel very comfortable with that because then somebody's imposing their religion on others." So they don't understand at that point in the course the bigger picture that I would argue.
This is a very Catholic perspective. Well, here in Spain, most of the people are Catholic or non-Catholic. Well, actually, there are a bit of Islam, but
yeah.
It's not really popular.
I don't know how to jump ahead here. I'm going to. Here, I'm going to jump to, that's not where I wanted to jump. Can I go backwards? No, I can't. Okay, I think this answers your question here. Why can't this be big now? So I've looked at I did a literature search on all the secular management journals looking at the top five religions. So what do Buddhism, Christianity, Confucianism, Hinduism, and Islam say about this issue? About are they mainstream or are they multi-stream, using that language? And I found a bunch of articles, and then I analyzed those articles. And how, so I call this God on Management. Pretty striking title, I think. What does God say about management? So then let's talk about how does God speak about management? Does God speak via scriptures or via spiritual practices? So you have a bunch of articles that talk about scriptures, a bunch of articles that talk about spiritual practices. And then what does God say about management? And you talk about the enhancement of the mainstream. So God says mainstream is good. If you're making a lot of money, that means God is blessing you. And that's how it's often framed, right? Oh, God blessed me with a high salary or a windfall of some sort, lots of profits. Or is God talking about the liberation from mainstream? It's not about money. It's about common good and dignity and treating people with respect and stuff. So what does God say about management? Going to your question. 80% of the articles talked about the scriptures. So God is speaking to management via scriptures, via the Analects, the Bible, Quran. And this is, again, all five religions have this. Of those, 45% say God likes mainstream, and 55% says God likes multi-stream. And that's across all religions. So what religious stripe you have, there's an argument to be made both ways. We are clever. We can take those scriptures and have them say what we want, can't we? We've done that before. But then what's very interesting to me is that 20% of the articles talked about meditation, prayer, mindfulness, those kinds of things. And 100% said it's about mainstream, a multi-stream. So if you talk to religious people who are trying to put this into practice, and you study their changes in values, you empirically look at that, that's supporting the multi-stream side. So I don't think there's going to be debates among different religions in that sense. There'll be tendencies in different schools of thought, but that's where that question gets answered. Okay. So let's go back to where we were. Okay. Other questions or comments? Okay then, let's go to this thing here. Planning, organizing, leading, controlling. So it's probably more research and more confirmatory research in the goal setting area than any other area in organizational behavior. And most textbooks talk about we need SMART goals. Specified, measurable, achievable, results-based, time-specific. I'm assuming most of you have learned that or taught that probably already. Even the people who talk about SMART goals say, that's only good for goals that you can measure, that you can quantify. What about all the goals you can't quantify? How do you quantify compassion? We're going to increase our compassion by 20% this year. You can probably do something there. But what about goals? So we call them SMART 2 goals. Significant, meaningful, agreed upon. They're not imposed top down and set. They're relevant. The goals that are important today might not have been important 10 years ago. Or something 10 years from now might be different and timely. It's a different way of thinking about goal setting. What does it mean to set SMART goals? And this is actually, we just had a paper published in Management Decision talking about that part of the chapter. So we've been doing that. I mean, when I wrote the book, I realized there's a lot of articles that could be published here. Should I write a bunch of articles or should I write a book? And for me, it was more important to write a book and bring it into the classroom, and now we've been sort of writing articles based on that, but for me, it's more interesting to write the book at this point.
Timely means?
That means it's not timeless, it's almost. It's saying, this is appropriate for now. So now Spain is in this situation, and you just won the soccer, this is a timely goal for us now. Maybe that's not a good example. Pardon me?
Is it like meeting deadlines?
It can be meeting deadlines, but here it's more, it's appropriate, it's relevant for the times. Yeah. It's you're still meeting deadlines, but it's not time specific. This is, you have a deadline and you better meet it. This is, you should be doing this now. This is the right time to do it. And that, go ahead. Yeah, it's a small difference, you're right. So this is maybe meaningful for the people involved more, and this is significant for larger society. So, but there are interchangeable. I mean, what's the difference between specified and measurable too? I mean, that's part of the problem of these acronyms. Okay.
Yep. Isn't there one step missing? Execution? Because that's where most people get being mainstream when executing.
So that's where the agreed upon part comes in, right? So the execution, and we talk about that goes in a number of the chapters, obviously. I mean, management decision-making. I ask my students, why is it called management decision-making? Why are we expecting managers to make all the decisions? That doesn't fit with subsidiarity, I think you guys call it. Why can't we let the people who are in the front lines who know the stuff make the decisions? So it's that kind of an idea, participative management, those kinds of things. The other thing that is important for my students in that textbook is my case studies. So each opening chapter has a different case. And those are, I call them my chocolate chips. Those are, this is sort of fun. This actually works. There's companies that do this. So there's a company called Semco. That's one of the students' favorite companies. Do you guys know Semco? Semco? Ricardo Semler from Brazil. He took over his dad's company when he was like 22 years old. And this was a marine pump manufacturing company that had, I forget, 300 employees or something. And his dad said, here's the manuals, here's everything, you take over the company. And he said, I don't want to babysit these people. These guys are all older than me. They know more than I do. I'm going to empower them. So if you work at Semco, you choose your own hours, you choose your own salary, you choose your own boss. It's a different kind of a place to work. When you get hired, you don't get hired in a specific area. It's called the lost in space. You get hired and you work here for a while, and you work here for a while, and you work here for a while. They have six people in their top management team. Each one takes, I think, a six-month turn to be the CEO, and then somebody else's turn, and somebody else's turn. They don't have offices the way we do. They're all open air. At meetings, you don't take minutes, because once you take minutes and everybody says, oh, it's in the minutes. No, you do what's timely, you do what's relevant. He's been voted the CEO of the year in Brazil for 2 years by his 25,000 other CEO friends. This company is making millions of, it's growing and growing in a tough time. So he's walked marching to the beat of a different drum, and it works, and my students love it. This is cool.
Sorry, what's the name of the company?
Semco, S-E-M-C-O. His name is Ricardo Semler. It's chapter, I don't know what chapter it is, 9, 10, somewhere in there. So organizing. Here it's centralization, and again, centralization, specialization, standardization, departmentalization. I'm just talking about one of those. We teach centralization. You defer to the person who's higher up on the hierarchy. It makes sense. That's why you set up a hierarchy. That's the person in charge, and this person. What about dignification, where everyone is treated with dignity? Why do we need this hierarchy anyway? Semler, Semco has three levels in their whole thing. And Ricardo Semler, the CEO, the owner, says sometimes there's no regular meetings. If you have something important to say, you say, we're going to have a meeting to talk about this important topic, and whoever wants to attend, attends. Who doesn't, doesn't. So Ricardo says, I called a meeting, nobody showed up. Guess it wasn't important. Everybody gets treated with dignity. Here it's the power of the leader. So we have leadership theory and what are the traits of a good leader and da-da-da-da-da. Here it's the power of the group, or the power of the leader to facilitate the group. It's a whole different way of thinking about leadership and what are leadership traits. It's not self-confidence, it's confidence in the group. It's not, I want to get ahead, I want us to get ahead, those kinds of things. For controlling, it's value chains versus what we call value loops or cradle-to-cradle thinking. So one of the examples in the textbook is interface. Interface carpeting, have you heard of interface carpeting? It's sort of the poster child in the States of sustainability. This is a company that makes, I think it's a $1 billion company that makes floor tiles, except they're carpeting tiles in 50 different countries and has, I don't know, lots of employees. And the owner, the person who founded it, was asked, what do you guys do about sustainability? And he didn't quite know how to answer that question, so he read some books, and then all of a sudden he became convicted, and he said, "There's interface has billions of tons of garbage in landfills. Someday people like me are going to be thrown in jail. This is not the way to run a business. Look at all the toxic emissions. Look at all the chemicals I'm using." So he put up a 30-year plan. He called it Climbing Above Mount Everest. So he wanted to be environmentally neutral. Actually, he wanted to be going more than that. He wanted to give back more to the planet than the planet was taking from him. So he set up all these teams, a whole organization bought into it, and basically if you buy carpet there, you can't, I don't know if you still can buy carpet, but the preferred way is to lease that carpet, and then when it gets old, you take away the old carpet, put in new carpet, but that old carpet goes back to the factory, gets reconstituted into new carpet. So there's no waste, it's all cyclical. And he does that at an ecological level and also at a social level. People working in factories in Southeast Asia have the same number of bathrooms as people who work in factories in North America. They have the same kinds of opportunities. But it's a cradle-to-cradle thinking. It's a cycle that we're doing. So that's a quick overview of the two approaches for management. Just to make a little bit more zoom in on one of those, Michael Porter is probably the most well-known scholar or practitioner even in strategy. And he talks about two basic kinds of strategy, cost leader strategy and differentiation strategy. And I've read interviews with Michael Porter, and he says, I'm consciously aware of the fact that when I put these kinds of titles on things, I am shaping how people think. He doesn't talk about our moral points of view, but by buying into this, you're buying into a moral point of view. Cost leader, you're increasing profits by reducing financial expenses while maintaining quality. So how do you do that? Well, you probably do that by creating externalities. You don't pay your employees as much. You source things from overseas, or you pollute more, or as much as how do you do that? There's externalities involved there. Differentiation is offering a unique product or service that customers pay extra for. You know this stuff, I'm assuming. Minimizer, what if we called it a minimizer and a transformer? A minimizer strategy is to minimize overall, holistic, total costs. It's not just your financial costs. What are your costs to the environment, to the neighborhood, to your employees? So you provide products and services in a way that limits all costs, including ecological, social, and financial externalities. You internalize externalities. That's a strategy. That's worth pursuing. It makes us sort of feel a bit thin, hollow. A transformer strategy, you provide products and services by redeeming previous waste. So what are the underutilized resources? The example that I usually use in class is a place called Grayston Bakery in New York. This is a bakery that hires ex-convicts. People who couldn't get a job, they got out of jail. Are they going to go back into crime, or are they going to get a real job? The bakery says, come, we'll give you a real job. You earn that job. And so the recidivism rate goes down, so people don't go back into jail. They're making the world a better place. Other example might be minimizing stress at work. Did you know that research shows that parents who have more stressful jobs tend to have children who are more likely to commit suicide? So when we say we don't want a stressful job, even then, it's usually within the mainstream paradigm, because if it's a stressful job, they won't work as hard. We want them to work harder, we want them to be loyal, and we don't want a high turnover. Those are all good things, but there's these externalities. It's affecting their family life. It's affecting their life in the community. How do we put those things into what we teach and how we think about what it means to be a manager? Oh, I'd put this one in here too. Resource-based view is probably the top strategy perspective now. And it says organizations should get resources that are valuable, rare, inimitable, that means hard to copy, and non-substitutable. Because if you have valuable resources, you can capture more values, what strategy talks about. You can enhance your profitability, you can increase your revenues, enhance monopoly, and protect financial interests. Makes total sense. From a multi-stream emphasis, it turns upside down. A valuable resource is one that enhances the well-being of humankind. Of course that's a valuable resource. Who cares about making more profit? Profit is nice, but it's a piece of paper, it's a symbol, it's not a bad thing. But if you're enhancing the well-being of humankind, that's worth pursuing. That's a valuable resource. If it's a rare resource, then you have an increased need for responsibility. There's only one planet Earth. It's very rare. How do we act with it responsibly? Are we going to use it to enhance our profitability and exploit it and you do all this pollution stuff? Or are we going to treat it with care and respect and dignity? This is our common home, right? If it's hard to copy, then you have a responsibility to teach others. We're making the world a better place. And protect stakeholder overall well-being. I've used this paradigm in research on small-scale farming. So I'm an organizational theorist, and the most popular or the most common organization in the world are small-scale farms. That's farms smaller than 2 hectares. There's 500 million small-scale farms on the planet. most of those in low-income countries. And we have the resource, and 70% of the world's chronically malnourished people, 70% of the people on the planet who are starving are small-scale farmers. Here's a population of organizations that's very needy. Here I am, an organization theorist, helping organizations. What do I do? How can I help them? It turns out there's something called conservation agriculture. It's an agronomic device that says, here's how small-scale farms can double their productivity and enhance the quality of the soil and have fewer externalities. You can do it, you can double productivity with industrial farming by putting more chemicals and GMO and stuff, or you can do it in this organic way. So I've studied organizations that are doing it in this organic way, and I've used this framework. And it's very clear, when you're helping the poorest of the poor, 500 million of them, this is the theory that makes sense. This works. This doesn't make sense. That's not what people are doing. They're saying, this is a valuable resource. How can we get people to do it? And the agronomists, the international development people in this area, are saying, you management scholars, help us, please. Your mainstream theories suck. They're not helping us at all. Give us something that works. And this is working better. And I can talk about that for a while too, but I won't here. So that's mainstream and multi-stream management. Next, I think we have accounting. But let's stay with management for a sec. Any questions on this, or are you getting the language? I mean, I can only do a little bit in this kind of a session, but it's a different way of thinking. And the students are now at the end of the lecture, well, what do I think is the right way of thinking about resources, a valuable resource? So they're torn. They're compelled, they're drawn into, they're almost forced to think about who they are and what they want to become. Comments or questions? Or should we jump right into accounting, our favorite topic? Okay. Let's look at accounting. So this is a paper that actually started off as a paper looking at, I think it was a parable of the talents or something, I forget which one it was, and then it grew into two separate papers. So this is now a paper that was in Business and Society Review, which is a very nice journal. If you're not familiar with it, it's like Business and Society, but it's a little bit easier to get into, I think. They're a bit more open-minded. So for papers of this ilk, that might be a place for you to consider too. So within the accounting, they don't have four functions of accounting. They have four generally accepted accounting principles. So there's assumptions. So there's the entity assumption, the unit of measure, the periodic reporting, and the going concern assumption. So let's look at the entity assumption. What unit of analysis is being held accountable? From a mainstream perspective, the entity is the firm, defined narrowly as a single unit clearly separated from its owners, members, and society. So this is what's being held accountable. That's what our theory is focusing on. That's what it means to be an accountant. From a multi-stream approach, the entity is the firm, defined broadly as multifaceted entity, intimately connected with its owners, members, and society. Here you have a whole bunch of externalities that were created. We want to make money in this little area here. You're saying we want to make the world a better place in this big area, or bigger area here, not by doing externalities, not by offloading things and underpaying our employees and underdoing this, but by creating a wholesome organization. Unit of measure. What's the firm being held accountable for? So what are we accounting for? Well, here the unit of measure is money. And the firm is accountable to maximize its financial resources, for example, its assets minus its liabilities. This can result in commodification and instrumentalization. So here accounting is all about money, and everything has to give, can you put money on compassion? Well, it's worth this many dollars. Everything becomes a commodity. Everything is instrumentalized. Everything is money. Here, there are multiple measures of units of measure. Money, ecological footprint, how many resources are we using up in our business, providing meaningful work. You can organizations do that. They, you know, how much do you enjoy your job and what's your job satisfaction? Being a good neighbor? There's multiple measures that accountants could be looking at. And they do with social audits and things like that, but that's sort of on the side. It's not part of the core of what they're doing, right? And the firm is accountable to balance multiple forms of well-being for multiple stakeholders. It fosters complexity and mutual discernment. I had a guest speaker in my class who's an accountant, and she says, well, she's the head of accounting or finance, I think, because she was actually head of finance. She said, at my former job, it was mainstream. It was great. I was the boss. I made decisions. I told people what to do. They did it. It was easy. Now I'm in this place that's more multi-stream, and I have to talk to people, and I have to get them on side, and I have to understand this, and I've got to get these other multiple measures going here, and I love it. This is interesting. This is cool. This is me. It's not nearly as simple. I'm not in charge as much, but this is a great job. I get to know people, I get to work with them, we talk about all sorts of interesting, meaningful things. It's a wonderful place to work. Periodic reporting. Reporting is according to calendar time, so it's linear. At the end of the month, at the end of every quarter, you have to report something. And it's serving the short-term interests of investors. It always shocks me. Now the European economy is different than the North American economy in terms of varieties of capitalism. So you guys are more long-term oriented than we are in North America. But it shocks me how decisions are made just for the quarterly reports. It doesn't make sense. Here, reporting takes into account the natural rhythms or seasons of organizational life. Kairos time instead of Kronos time. Serving the interests of long-term stakeholders. So why are we doing this, all this short-term stuff? That doesn't make sense. We're marching to the beat of a Wall Street drum that isn't functional in terms of making the world a better place. There's a theory behind that, I know. But there's a lot of good theory that says this is not serving the interests of humankind. So can we change, think of accounting differently? Going concern is really these three put together again. So what criteria are used to decide whether an entity is viable? The assessment of whether a firm is financially viable, going concern, one, has a short-term time horizon, usually 1 year. Two, focuses on financial measures. And three, is at the level of analysis of the single entity, ignoring long-term non-financial externalities. Here, the assessment of whether a firm is holistically sustainable, going concern, one, has a long-term time horizon. For example, it considers the effect on future generations. Takes into account multiple forms of well-being and considers contributions and drawbacks of the entity in the context of its larger social and ecological systems. So internationalization and globalization of accounting is getting the whole world to sort of think through that lens. And that's sort of the standard, and this stuff is sort of getting pushed away. Yep. Oh, so the leading versus managing that, yeah. Sure, yes is the short answer. The longer answer is you can have leaders in here, and you could probably have managers in here too. So the managers, leaders are transformational and transactional, I think is sort of also what you're thinking about. This is clearly more transactional. So there's truth to that, yeah. Now, is this the time to talk about taxes?
What particularly are you interested in talking about taxes?
Maybe about this, it's about the balance between the responsibility of the individuals and the responsibility of the state in common law.
Mm-hmm.
And how taxes could be or not a way to get involved in that common law.
Mm-hmm.
So, there are many, many questions.
Let me tell a story on that. So when I, especially when I teach my sustainability course, my students say, well, the government should do this. And I say, yeah, maybe the government should, but this is a business school and what can we as business do? So that's how I avoid that. But I know that there's courses on government and business and society, and you need to deal with that. But the story I'm going to tell is about the economy of communion. Are you familiar with the economy of communion?
Yes.
That's under the Focolare movement. That's a Catholic movement, and there's about 1,000 firms now doing that. Pardon me? Yes. Yep. Economy of Communion, EOC. It's a very inspiring organization or movement. So these, the Focolare movement started off by being charitable. So we're going to give our stuff to the poor people. And that's, the leader is Chiara Lubich.
Chiara Lubich.
And she said, yeah, so for 30 years we've been giving away stuff, and that's a good thing to do. But how do we create the stuff in the first place? Maybe we should create businesses that provide jobs for these people so they don't have to get handouts anymore, and that create profits so that we can give more stuff away. And now this business that you have becomes, for the managers, it becomes a spiritual expression of their faith. So it's not just praying or going to mass. Going to work is a spiritual dimension of their faith. They're doing what they're supposed to do. They're making the world a better place. They're helping people. And this is a manifestation of that. So these firms got started doing that. And the way it was set up is 1/3 of the profits go back into the firm. 1/3 goes for educational purposes. And 1/3 goes to a centralized location where it gets redistributed. And initially the idea was that this was going to be a money generator for the movement so they could do more work. But what started happening is the managers started paying more taxes because they knew there were loopholes and they could get away with taxes, and they didn't feel good about that. So we're going to pay more taxes. The managers started doing less externalities. Well, we could pollute here and it's legal, but it's not the right thing to do. We're not going to do this pollution. The managers started hiring people from the slums or from the outside areas. Maybe they could get higher, better qualified people, but those people need jobs. So they created these businesses that did a lot of multi-stream things, is what they did. So I have that in that book. That's where I first read about them. It's a very inspiring movement. So in terms of taxes, those are Catholic multi-stream organizations that said we should be paying our fair share of the taxes, or more than we could get away with less, but we want to do more, basically. So I don't know if that's an answer or not.
I have one comment on that about the taxes. I got one manager who thought that by paying taxes, he was acting as social responsible. So I'm social because I pay taxes. I do not need to do anything more.
Yeah.
So for some bad managers, I would say, when you are talking about being social, being a good neighbor, they could think that that's for taxes, as far as I pay.
Oh, that's interesting, yeah.
I think that the measure of everything is money.
Like in Canada, we just had an election, and it was, vote for me, because you don't have to pay as many taxes. No, vote for me, because I'm going to cut your taxes. Personally, I don't mind paying taxes, because that's how I get a school for my kids, and that's how I get a hospital for me, and that's how I get good roads. So it's a good thing to pay taxes. It's a good thing. But the mainstream mantra is avoid taxes, right? So I would say that paying taxes is corporate social responsibility, but not... The original definition of corporate social responsibility meant going beyond profit-making activities, saying, hey, no, we could make more money doing something else, but we're going to be doing this charitable act, even though it's cutting away from our profits. That's what CS, corporate social responsibility, meant. And then it got co-opted. Then the mainstream guy said, yeah, but if I give money to that charity, that's like free marketing, and it's actually paying off. So I should do this corporate social responsibility because it's going to make me more money. So most of the corporate social responsibility literature and most of the sustainability literature is now co-opted and said, we're going to make more money doing that. And that's not the heart of those literatures for me, from my perspective. So I mean, creating jobs, you're doing corporate social responsibility. You're creating value for society. But how do you do it? And do you go beyond the minimum? That's corporate social responsibility for me, anyway. Other comments on accounting before I jump onto either finance or marketing? I forget what I have next. Is that helpful? Was just a little pipe dream here, and Bruno's in La La Land, and have fun there, Bruno. Okay. The four axioms of finance. So they don't have four functions, and they don't have four assumptions, but they have, actually, I think it's seven axioms I found, and I just looked at four because that would fit, barely fits anyways. So the risk-return trade-off. Investors demand higher rates of return for taking on more risky projects. We know that's common sense, right? That's common sense from a mainstream perspective. From a multi-stream approach, the risk-return trade-off, investors are willing to accept lower financial returns if the firm's risky projects have non-financial benefits for humankind. For example, enhanced socio-ecological well-being. So if I know that this bakery is hiring ex-convicts, or if I know that this firm is using organic cotton instead of non-organic cotton to make their jeans, or if I know that this is a wholesome, I'm willing to invest in them, and I'm not going to get I don't expect as much of a return on my investment because they're doing good things. I've just created jobs for all of these people that would otherwise be in living in crime. I feel good about that. That's worth the $500 or whatever extra money that I could have made. We've created jobs for these people. It's a different axiom. It's a different way of thinking about risk-return payoffs with your financial stuff. The time value of money. A dollar received today is worth more than a dollar in the future, because a dollar received today can collect interest or be invested in a profitable project so that it's worth more in the future. So do you want a dollar now or a dollar 10 years from now? Well, if you take that dollar now and put it in the bank, you'll have $2 or $1.50 or whatever in 10 years. That's the principle here. How about this time value of money? A dollar spent today on a worthwhile cause is worth more than a dollar in the future, because a dollar spent today can save a life that would have been gone tomorrow, or provide employment for someone who needs a job and wants to become a contributing member of society. There's a multiplier effect. So those of you in finance will be familiar with that. It's turning it on its head. So I'm going to save this money so that in the future I can give more to philanthropy. That's okay. Or am I going to give it to philanthropy now so it can do more in the intervening time? It's a different axiom. Here it's the curse of competitive markets. Competitive markets are bad. That explains why it's hard to find exceptionally profitable projects. The goal of financial managers is to maximize shareholder wealth, and the best way to achieve this is via exploiting some sort of competitive advantage that potential competitors can't duplicate. So this is Michael Porter, this is resource-based view of the firm, right? It's saying, we are going to essentially get a monopoly. We're using these tools to get a monopoly, so we're not really competing. And a lot of companies that have followed Michael Porter's advice have been sued or taken to court by the government for creating monopolies. We don't want real competition, we want a competitive advantage. The other side is the blessing of markets, not the curse of markets, the blessing of markets in the best sense of the word. What is a market? Explains why exceptionally profitable projects are wrong. It's wrong to make lots of money. Now Bruno's getting a little bit dangerous. The original idea of a market was a place where members of a community would gather, visit, and arrange to buy and sell goods and services. People in the market were neighbors, and a healthy community market was one where people treated one another with dignity and respect. Antagonism and dysfunctional status differentials would be created when one neighbor started to make exceptional profits due to having a monopoly, which is what having a needed, unique, inimitable products or service was called prior to being dubbed a competitive advantage. So in the original markets, there was a difference. There are status differentials. A doctor would make more than the shoemaker, would make more than the beggar or whatever. There was some status differential, but it was much more compressed. Once you make exceptional profits, I'm the only one selling this drug on the market. I can charge $100,000 because people will die if they don't buy it. That's an exceptional profit. That's not wholesome. So I don't know if you've been following what's happening in the drug industry, or if the same thing is happening here in Europe in terms of the large pharmaceuticals jacking up their prices because they know they can. They can get away with it. So what is it, a market? When we think of a market, we think of a commodity. It's all instrumental. What if we thought of a market as people? Huh. That would change our financial theory and thinking, wouldn't it? And the last one is the agency problem. So the agency problem says that managers will act in their own self-interests rather than in the shareholders' interests. Therefore, one needs financial compensation schemes that align managers' interests with the owners. So I'm the owner, I hire a manager, and that manager can take too much money and put it into his or her pocket, and I'm left out in the cold. They're not motivated to help me. So I've got to make sure that my manager's financial or compensation scheme reflects mine. So if he or she makes more money, then I make more money. That's how we solve the agency problem. Here it's the agency solution. Because of their proximity to all stakeholders, owners, employers, managers, customers, and neighbors, managers may be more sensitive to everyone's needs and thus be better equipped to have a more holistic and balanced approach than the owners would, who are at a distance from the other stakeholders and thus more likely to focus on their own self-interests. Huh. So because the owner is far away from what's happening down there, the owner doesn't know what the needs are. The manager is right in the middle of it. They know how to facilitate community. That's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. If the owner, you have these foreign investors, you have, in biblical times, you had the owners all in Rome, and these people are all being oppressed down there. The agency to have a manager in charge who knows what's going on there is a good thing. It's a solution. It solves the problem of these faceless it's out there, right? Using Buber's language. It's a different way of looking at finance. So when I showed this to a finance professor in the States, he rolled his eyes and said, yeah, okay, dream on. This is the real world. Why can't we create this real world? When my children were growing up, one of the first things, well, that's not one of the first things I taught them, but I taught them about the social construction of reality. I said, the reality we live in today is very different than 40 years ago, is different than 40 years back then, and will be different again in 40 years. So one of the leading managers he talked about when he was in business school in the 1950s, the mantra of profit maximization and shareholder wealth creation, he didn't learn that in business school. That wasn't normal yet. In the 1980s, that's when that became at the apex. That's when it all about profit maximization, shareholder wealth, that became the mantra. So Milton Friedman and people like that. He says, for students nowadays going into the future, money is important, but you're going to have to do a lot more with the externalities. We're not going to put up with that anymore. So the world that our students are creating, the business world, can look very different in 40 years than it does now. And so, actually, one of the students' favorite chapters is the history chapter in that book. And why do students like history? I don't know, maybe students are more amenable to history here than in Canada. Typically, students don't like history. But what they like about that book is they can see that it's a social construction of reality. Just like 80 years ago, we didn't have words like this. 80 years from now, we'll have different words, and we are creating that. We have the power to change what our parents screwed up, basically. Are we ready for marketing?
Yeah.
Okay. Here's marketing. I'm actually working on a variation of this with a colleague, Raj Manchanda, and we're looking at sustainable marketing, and we're looking at Sustainable Marketing 1.0 versus Sustainable Marketing 2.0. And multi-stream is sort of like 2.0. So this is a bit of an oversimplification, and I'd probably change this if I based it on that, but that still makes the point. So marketing has the four Ps, if you remember, the product, price, place, and promotion. So what do those four Ps look like through these two lenses? Here, product includes goods and services and ideas. It's not just a product, it's not just tangible, but a service is a product too. From a mainstream approach, basically organizations should provide goods, services, or ideas that have features that satisfy customer needs or wants. So they're creating value, they're giving something to society. Especially desirable are products that customers want that can't get elsewhere. So you're the only one who's got this patented, really cool blue scooter or whatever it is that you have. A multi-stream approach, and some of the marketing literature goes here already too. The product goes beyond specifiable goods or services offered by an organization. Rather, the product includes the relationships and connections formed among organizations and people in the creation, distribution, and usage of the product. Especially desirable are products that nurture community and help the needy. How many different kinds of scooters do we need? Or how many different kinds of toothpaste do we need? Or how many different kinds of whatever do we need? You probably have too many of most things. How many different kinds of services do we have for low-income people? Maybe not enough. Maybe we should be developing more of those products. Or when we develop our products, we should be thinking more holistically. Not just how does this serve the needs of my customer, but also my customer's children and my neighbors and future generations. How do we build that thinking into a product? It's not just an entity here, it's a connection, right? So when we drink coffee, we're not just drinking this coffee, we're drinking the sunshine that was growing on the coffee beans in Africa before it was shipped here on big container ships and creating pollution and come into the factory, and the factory workers maybe were underpaid, and we're buying that. That's what that product is. It's not just coffee, it's got all of that embedded in it. And how do we then get fair trade coffee or fair trade chocolate and those kinds of things? And I can talk about that for a while too. Price. Here it refers to the financial amount consumers are willing to pay for a product, especially desirable or products that are in such high demand that you can have a higher markup. Includes not only the financial price that customers pay for a product, but also its externality, the social costs and benefits not reflected in the price. Especially desirable are products whose prices reflect their true overall costs. So if I show my students a video about two pairs of jeans, and I say, you know, here's a sticker price of those two pairs of jeans. This is what you're paying, that's the price, but what's the non-sticker price? And then you go back and say, well, was this cotton organically farmed or not organic or environmentally friendly? So where's the cotton come from? The dyes, are there toxins going into the river? Most of this is happening in China, and there's a lot of places where they just throw it out there and they pollute. And there's some places that have standards associated with them. Is this sweatshop labor, or what kind of labor is it? So you look at all these background things, these invisible things, that should all be part of price. And we should be teaching our students how to make that transparent. And there are apps that are starting to do that now. Say, here's the price, but here's sort of the externalities that this company has versus that company. Here are the standards that they're following or not. So price, to say it's a financial price, that's too simple. It's much more than that. Place, location in the distribution network sometimes. Refers to the competitive advantage an organization has in selling its products thanks to its location in the distribution network. Especially desirable are locations that are consumer friendly. Or when you're operating from a position of power, when you're the biggest player in town, then you have a good place in that distribution network. Walmart has a good place. Rather than see the organization as a separate, self-centered entity that is trying to outcompete others, from a multi-stream approach, the organization is seen as part of a larger network, cooperating with others. Especially desirable are networks that are characterized by trust and mutual fulfillment. Again, it sounds very far from here. There's a new literature being developed called place-based organizing. So from a mainstream perspective, we live in a flat world. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't make a difference. It's all about access and computer and da-da-da-da. Place-based organizing says it's important where you are. That's the key. If you want to be a sustainable organization in an ecologically sustainable way, and I'd argue also socially, you need to understand where you are. Who are you? What's the geography around you? Who are your neighbors? What's your effect on the ecosystem? What's your effect on the social structure and system? What's your place? It's a much deeper, more compelling, I would argue, understanding or way of thinking about place. And the last one is promotion. Promotion refers to the activities designed to sell products, like advertising and sales. Especially valuable are promotion strategies that are low cost and high impact. For example, word of mouth, that's a great promotion strategy. Unsolicited testimonials, so that's why people try to get Facebook and those kind of things involved here. Here, promotion is rather than simply sell products and push information in one-to-many transaction or one-to-one relationships. So the marketing literature is how do we get our message out, right? It's all about getting it out. A multi-stream approach intentionally fosters multi-directional listening and collaboration. Especially valuable communication is evident when others in the network play a key role in co-creating products and services. So it's not about us having the message and getting it out. It's about us listening to what kind of value can we create. That's how we can create products that are whatever multi-stream products and sensitive to multi-stream price considerations and multi-stream place considerations. It's much more about listening rather than imposing. I forget the numbers, but it's as much money spent on advertising as in all of higher education in the world, kind of an idea. Newspapers. We think of newspapers and TV stations as this is where we get our news, and this is sort of, yeah, there's advertising in there, but this is our source of news. I forget that. I think the numbers are that 75% of revenues from media come from advertising. And 75% of advertising comes from the top 100 corporations, something like that. So the world's top 100 corporations are paying for half of our news, our newspaper. And do you think they have an agenda about what kind of stories are put in there and what we read there? Of course they do. What are the mainstream values that they're trying to promote or that are specific there? I remember Procter and Gamble once had a policy, we will not support advertising on any TV show that makes fun of managers. Managers are in some ways, are gods. They're in some ways, this is the guru, this is the wise figure, this is an important player, and we're not going to challenge this mainstream stuff. It's not allowed, verboten. So in Canada, there's an organization that tries to, it creates advertisements that say that driving a car isn't good. It creates all this pollution. Please don't drive cars. And they do it more graphically than that. And then they go to our TV station and say, how much do you charge for a minute or half a minute ad? This much. Well, we'd like to buy this ad. And the TV station say, no, we can't play your ads, because if we do that, the cars won't get sold. We won't get their advertising anymore. For every new car sold is an average of $1,000 in advertising cost. It's crazy. Yep.
Starting to do their own like products. I mean,
yeah.
This is the main new generation that are identifying every single need, and they don't rely on big companies anymore. So some people, just an individual, might find a need. I don't know, the traffic, weather. They will create an app,
yeah.
And they will just use self networking by Facebook or whatever.
For example, there was a new Facebook that they are controlling the news on their net, and they select what like 75% of the people in the US is reading. So it's the same thing in other environments.
Yeah.
No, the thinking is that there's more and more people building their own apps. Sometimes they're even building their own products related to 3D printers and things like that. They can make small apps and gadgets in order to do that.
Yeah.
So I think the big question is, once an application becomes a big one, I don't know, let's talk, I don't know, WhatsApp or any traffic application, weather application, there will become, again, a traditional main street approach because of, you know, they need to have a company. Facebook used to be a really small network, but today it's one of the biggest companies in the world. And somehow they went back to the old fashioned kind of, mainstream.
Yeah. And is that a lack of imagination on my part as a business professor? If I'm saying, this is the world, it's a mainstream world, and here's all the tools for you to manage your world through mainstream thinking, and I'm not saying, here's another way of looking at the world, here's another way of being an organization, of being a business. I mean, Google is maybe a bit of an exception. They're doing some things a little bit differently just because they can and whatever, you know, do no evil. There's a lot of bad things Google's doing, but I think they're trying harder than some of these other ones to create information and to empower people and those kinds of things. But what I find exciting is there's a lot of young people, 22-year-olds, who are starting up companies that are making the world a better place. They're not trying to make the big hit. I mean, there's the video that I show to my students is called 31 Bits. So this is in Uganda, and this is a bunch of people said, you know, Uganda's a terrible place, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But we went to Uganda, and we found these women who are underemployed. And we taught them, and they learned and taught us how to make jewelry out of recycled paper. It's beautiful jewelry. We're taking these unemployed single women, teaching them some basic business skills, giving them a job, they're learning English, and we're selling their jewelry in the States. So jewelry isn't a particularly wholesome product, you're still not feeding people or whatever, but they're using their imagination saying, we're not gonna get rich off of this, the goal isn't to get rich off of this, the goal is, we have now helped 72 women get on their legs, they were beggars and now they're independent and they can send their kids to school. That's the satisfaction. And there's more and more of those kinds of stories. And for my students, they love that. They would like to be that person. They would like to make the world a better place. My students are much more entrepreneurially interested now than they were 10 years ago. And they're much more, we have to fix the world that our parents' generation screwed up. They have to clean the environment. They have to look after the widening income gap and stuff. Yeah.
When you make reference to your students, what is the profile of the student? Are they Christians? Are they believing Christians? Are they nominal Christians? Are they atheists? What are they?
I would say less than 10% would be calling themselves Christian. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's a pretty. But that said, there's.
What would the others call themselves?
Canadians. There is more and more interest in things like yoga and meditation and mindfulness. I see that in student reports and the things that they do. And I also see there's new interest in church kinds of activities, going to Christian church or going to other churches too, where, hey, this church or this mosque has this, I don't know if it's once a month or every week, but you know they get together, they have food and they distribute meals to people, soup kitchen kinds of things. And students are intrigued by that. They like to participate in that. So there is an interest in those more, I don't know, philanthropic or charitable or altruistic kinds of ideas.
One question about marketing. How do you distinguish when the company is finding a necessity, which is in the customer, so I am covering and giving an answer to that necessity, or when I am creating a necessity, so mm-hmm. creating mm-hmm. a dependent mm-hmm. customer, mm-hmm. that he has to buy something that he didn't
When I took my marketing course, the paper that I wrote for my professor was exactly that. I said, look, on page chapter 1 of this book, it says, marketing is here to serve the customer. And by chapter 10, it's marketing is here to create needs so the company can make money. And how do we get from here to here? And how can we envision a world where we stay on this side? And I mean, the world is a messy place, so I know we're gonna be on the continuum somewhere. We can't be purely here, just like nobody's really purely there, but we can try to shift that direction. So that's a nuanced kind of a question. Say, yeah, okay, here we are, this is a cash cow, or we're creating this need, and consumers don't really need that. Well, maybe we should stop selling those things. Mm-hmm. So in Winnipeg, there's a grocery store that's in the downtown inner city, and where the poor people live. That's how it is in Winnipeg, at least. And most grocery stores would have cigarettes right in the front, because that's what people want to buy, and junk food and candies. And these people have said, even though it's going to make us less money, we're not going to put those by the cash register. Rather, we're going to have apples and bananas and wholesome things. And in fact, if a child comes through, we're going to give that child a free apple. So they have made conscious decisions not to sell certain things that they recognize aren't wholesome, even though they're financially. And so they've made those. So we need to celebrate those kinds of companies more and say, yeah, this can be done. This company is doing that. Chocolate chips. We need more of those chocolate chips. Yep.
In the multi-stream approach, you are talking about many values that are hidden or are invisible. How do you make people or society to be aware of that values in order pursue them?
Yeah.
I mean, you need the culture in your side. How do you create that?
Yeah.
In the society to work, to feel good with that values and to appreciate them in your products.
Right now, I mean, one thing I tell my students is, you need to sell to people like me. I have means, so I can pay more for this jar of jam if it's a local jam, or this organically or healthy raised chicken rather than just. So there's a store in Winnipeg called Crampton's Food Market, I think it's called. And they buy stuff from the local farmer, they sell organic stuff, they sell their meat is all free range and those kind of things, and it costs more. It costs more money to sell those things because it costs more to create them. But if you consider the externalities, it's probably less. Right now, the beef industry in the world is creating as much greenhouse gas as all of the cars in North America. Right now, the subsidies for the beef industry, and I don't know how they exactly calculate this, the subsidies are worth more than the actual beef industry. It's $500 billion or something. There's a lot of externalities built into our food, at least in North America, I'm imagining here too. So maybe I'm gonna pay, instead of buying a steak for a dollar at the store that's got these externalities, I'm paying $1.50 for this free range or organic steak, that's not maybe a good example. But this $1 one really is costing society $2, so I'm saving society 50 cents, but I'm paying it out of my own pocket. But I want to create that movement, so I do that. So that's what we do. And the owner of this Crampton's Food Market, Erin Crampton, says, yeah, she has to talk a lot to customers and explain to them how this works and what the choices are. But there is a growing demand, and I can see that demand, and I see it in my students. I know that even 5 or 10 years ago, when I talked to my students about sustainability, they weren't convinced. Convince me that this is important, Bruno. Now they say, we know this is important, tell me how to do it. So there's been a shift in that generation. I don't know if the same thing is in Spain or not, if the new generation is more aware of those kinds of issues. But there is a market for this. My friend started an organic vegetable farm, and there was a little article in our newspaper that said this guy outside the city is starting this, it's called shared farming. Are you familiar with community supported agriculture? Basically, you pay, I don't know, 300 euros to a farmer, and that farmer provides you with 20 weeks of vegetables. So he was going to start this, and there's no address, no telephone number, anything like that. And that next day, I think he had 200 people phone directory assistance. There's this farmer, Dan Weens, who's starting this farm. Can you give us his phone number? We want to buy in. So there's a pent-up demand there, I think. So it's up to getting our students to say, yeah, there's this pent-up demand. How are you going to take advantage of it and make these alternative organizations that help you increase the common good and treat people with dignity and all those things? Yep.
You asked what in Spain. There is a club called Club de Excelencia para Sostenibilidad, which is integrating 17 of the 35 IBEX, which is the NASDAQ, is like the biggest corporations that are in the stock market. And they get compromises people like Visa, or even for example, big companies, breweries like Mao, and make compromises on reducing all the kind of environmental tracking, etc. For example, in packaging, they spend tons of money researching on how can we reduce the impact on packaging of bottles or cartons for distribution, etc. For example, using trucks or vehicles that are not contaminating, etc. And they are using a big
And I've read about, I mean, Walmart even is doing a lot of good things. There's a lot of good companies doing that. Is it enough and is it soon enough is the question that maybe we as scholars need to reflect on. But you're right, there's a lot of good things happening. There was a recent study of managers around the world. I think there's 2,000 managers in 30 countries. And they're asking about their companies. Are your companies addressing social issues and ecological issues, and you know, are they sustainable? And half of the managers said that their company was now largely or fully addressing social and ecological sustainability issues. And so that's very encouraging. This is becoming real. On the other hand, the largest 3,000 companies are creating $2 trillion of negative externalities. So are we putting our heads in the sand? Well, we reduced our stuff by 10% or by whatever, but it's still a huge amount that's left over. So is that enough? Do we need these other models? That's the question. Okay. So putting these things together, so managers as moral agents. I sort of talked about this already. Teaching two ideal type approaches to management sensitizes students to the fact that managers are moral agents. Management is not value neutral. And that's a huge lesson, I think. Most of societies, it's all about efficiency. Efficiency isn't a value-laden idea. Maximizing profits isn't even value-laden. That's just normal, right? Well, those are value-laden ideas. 300 years ago, those weren't the norms. To maximize profit was seen as greed, was seen as sin, was seen as bad. But now it's a blessing from God, right? So we've changed. Help students think about what sort of manager they want to become, and it provides alternatives. It's not just, when I started off teaching, I remember my first few years saying, okay, I'm teaching the mainstream textbook, the mainstream stuff, and I know that there's bad things in here in terms of students are just being socialized into one moral point of view. So I created little windows in my course and said, well, that's how you, management decision making, that's how you make decisions, but you could also do participative decision making, or you could have SMART 2 goals, or you could do this kind of, so I was giving them these little opportunities, these little snippets of outside of the mainstream box thinking. And I thought I was doing them a great service and they're planting these alternatives. But then when, I remember one year in particular where there was a student I knew who was looking for alternatives, and I asked her at the end of the class, so, did you like the course? Well, it was all mainstream. Didn't you get my, no, I didn't see any of those windows. And that sort of was an eye-opener for me that this mainstream stuff is very powerful, it's very pervasive, that's what we've written about. To do the multi-stream stuff is hard work. For me to write that textbook was probably like two dissertations worth of work. It wasn't, I wanted it to have empirical grounding, I wanted it to be strong, and I wanted to think these things through logically. So there's a formal rationality of multi-stream management, and it hangs together and it makes sense as a whole. And for me to expect my students to have done that was very naive. I mean, they don't have the training or the education that I do, and they don't have the time that I do. It takes time to develop this alternative formal rationality. But that's, I think, part of what taxpayers want me to do. As a scholar, we want our educational institutions to provide alternatives, to provide critical thinking, to provide what the world needs in the future, not just what it needed 40 years ago, maybe. So it helps students think outside the box. It enhances critical thinking. We're in the business of education, not of training. I don't know if that means something in your schools or not. And it aids in understanding others. So now the mainstream manager, and if that's who you are, if my student is a mainstream manager, that's great. They now know who they are, but they also understand, oh, there's these other people in the world called multi-stream managers, and they never understood that before. That was foreign to them, but now it's not foreign. And multi-stream managers can at least understand mainstream managers. for me to talk about being bilingual, I'm guessing all of you are at least bilingual. Bilingual helps you to see the world through two lenses, through two ways. It enhances your critical thinking. It enhances your creative thinking. It's a gift to be bilingual. It's a gift to be bilingual in terms of management, mainstream and multi-stream. It gives you a much richer way of looking at the world. People's values are influenced by management practices and by the organization structures and systems they inhabit, and managers are moral agents. This is not a value-neutral activity that our students are going into.
No, I got one question. How do you measure or how do you evaluate and develop the critical thinking of the students? Could you give us any example of the activities you do?
Yeah. I don't do that specifically. In fact, in some courses, I won't even mention the word critical thinking. It just happens, because now they're understanding mainstream, and now they're understanding multi-stream. It's you're able to think in two languages. It's not, I have to teach you. Now you're thinking in English, and now you're thinking in Spanish. It just happens, and that is the critical thinking that happens. And then we measured it via a case. Said, here's a case, what's happening in this case? You know, who's doing what, and what should you be doing about it? So it was nothing to do with mainstream and multi-stream even. It was, now look at this case and see what's happening. And the students who had took the course with two approaches to management had a more nuanced, a richer understanding, a measurably richer understanding than ones who only took one. It's magic. So management instructors as moral agents, right? What we do isn't value neutral either. So this is what I asked my students, this is what we started with. Is it ethical for instructors to teach only one approach to management, knowing that students tend to adopt the values associated with that approach? Would it be okay for me to teach only multi-stream? Is it ethical for instructors to teach both, knowing that students are likely to place less value on materialism, individualism by the end of the course? So knowing that I'm manipulating them, is that ethical? Is that moral? Which way of teaching is more ethical, teaching only one approach or teaching two approaches? And the students, again, say 95% say teaching two approaches. Whoops, down here, two approaches. Some professors have argued to me, Bruno, but if you're teaching them multi-stream, that's not the real world. You're giving them a false sense of what the world is like. So that's not fair. You shouldn't do that. That's not a good thing to do. So we did a study. This was a different colleague had done a study or had written had his course on, he didn't call it mainstream and multi-stream, but it was a course on, I think, Lee Iacocca. Jack Welch. It was Jack Welch. Would you want to work for Jack Welch? Jack Welch is the prototypical mainstream manager. And they read all about Jack Welch, and they critiqued Jack Welch. And at the end of the term, do you want to work for a man like Jack Welch in your career? And then we followed up on those students. So two or three years later, we said, well, where are you working now? Is it a guy like Jack Welch, or is it somebody else? And students who wanted to work for a Jack Welch kind of manager were, and students who didn't, weren't. So there's degrees of freedom. I mean, I'm oversimplifying there. But students still have choices, and students want those choices, is what this is suggesting. I think that's the end of, here we go. Are we happy? Any more questions about mainstream and multi-stream or taxes or something? I don't think it's 1:30 yet, so what time is it?
It's
12. 12, okay, yep.
But it's a workshop, so it's their turn to talk, right?
Well, they've been having turns all the time. They haven't been taking them.
Yeah, Bruno, I just want to ask you about your authors, the bibliography you use, because, well, you're talking about multi-stream, and I was thinking about a lot of multiple authors that talk about these kind of things. You've been talking about the social Christian thought, or the Christian social thought, that is something, an anchor, a rock,
right.
Secure, that I was thinking about a lot of authors for the last 2 hours. I don't know whether they are Christians or not,
right.
But they are quite interesting.
Yep.
So I use them.
Yep.
For example, when you're talking about value capture, value creation, yep. Value chain of loops, of course I was thinking about Stefano Tamagno, for example. I know he's Christian, of course he's Catholic. He's talking about the common good. That's good. But for example, when you're talking about protect financial interest or protect stakeholders over our well-being, of course I'm thinking about Edward Freeman.
Mm-hmm.
When you were talking about reporting according to calendar time or taking into account the natural seasons of organizational life, I was thinking about this idea of handcrafting from Richard Sennett.
Mm-hmm.
He's neo-pragmatist. I don't know if he's Christian or not, but he's talking about this and in a really deep way. For example, when you're talking about the unit of measure that's money or another kind of things, of course I was thinking about the capabilities theory from Marta Nussbaum or Amartya Sen. And of course the four P's of marketing, I was thinking about David Jones. So what I say is that, of course, we have the gospel, the
mm-hmm.
Bible, and so on. But what about another of those? I don't know, it's like, who are your bedside books?
Value creation and value capture. Santos, I forget his first name, has written some very good stuff there. Semco, is Ricardo Semler, is a nice practical example. The Economy of Communion has, Lorna Gould was the book that I read there that was very inspiring for me along those lines. For me, whether it's from a Christian background or not isn't that much of an issue, to be honest. These are cool ideas. I like where this is going, and that's... So when I did the multi-stream, in one sense, it's new, but in another sense, I'm standing on all those shoulders of those giants, and I'm trying to pull it together into one worldview, right? One way of doing it. And there, some of them are in that situation, but for me, my opening framework, again, these two moral points of view that support these two formal rationalities, I think that's relatively unique to think about it in those terms, and saying, no, this is a whole new way of thinking about management than that one was. And let's pull all of those pieces together to form a whole, a coherent whole. And that's something that you guys could do at a school level. Well, what does this mean here, and what does it mean here, and what does it mean here? And it's providing windows, but the more and more you can flesh out those windows and make it as a... I know there's schools in the States that are doing that. They're trying to take this multi-stream stuff and infect their whole MBA program with it. So that is happening. Who else do I like to read? Adam Grant was a recent book that I read that I quite liked. I guess I read more articles and... I should step... I do a lot of diverse research. So this book was a lot of diversity. This week I was telling some people I got a paper accepted called Quantum Sustainable Organizing Theory. So I take quantum mechanics and ideas of entanglement and stuff. What does that mean for organization theory? And when I talked about those 500 million small-scale farmers, I've been to North Korea and China and Bolivia and Colombia looking at small-scale farmers. So maybe that's part of my problem, I think. I spread my, but I like it. That's the privilege that I have of being who I am, the job that I have. I can follow my nose and say, this is important and interesting, let's spend some time with it. So I'm not as narrow as I should be if I was a mainstream guy. It's all just efficient. This is fun for me too. Is this helpful? Is this inspiring? Is this getting you thinking about your courses and your research? Or is this, when is Bruno going to stop talking? Because I want to go have lunch soon, and I have some grading to do, and we'll see. Yep.
Yeah, for me it's wonderful, because you mentioned about the four P's, three clutter. I have always talked about the fifth, which is purpose.
Very nice.
The company has to have a purpose.
Yeah.
And based on this purpose, which is basically the market they want to serve,
yeah.
And the people they want to help, they create products, services, etc. And then it comes to rest now. So this was a line of thinking over the years. And nowadays we try, we heritage this our subject called Dirección de Recursos Humanos, which is basically human resources management.
Mm-hmm.
Like managing things or managing resources, which is not
the best. Yeah.
This is not
Yeah.
and we change it to people imagining the environment, which is basically thinking about the people and the person, the stockholders, what are really inside of the company. How are we going to develop them?
Yeah.
And integrate them in the company, in the site, etc. So what you have just talked this morning, for me is very inspiring, and I thank you for that.
Very good. I remember once, this was an MBA program, and there was a human resource management instructor asked me to be an actor in her class. So she had students who were managers, and they were supposed to manage this employee, and I was the employee. And my background was, I think my wife was sick or something, and I wanted to stay home more or something. I had some human need, and they wanted me to work harder. So I came in, we sat down, we had this meeting, and they were convincing me to work harder, more hours, and da-da-da-da. And I was saying, well, I don't think that's such a good idea, but then in the end, they won. They got me to work harder, that's how I played the game. And then after that, we had a panel of a real professional HR manager and professors in HR. And I was shocked when they said, those students did such a good job of managing me. No, here I had these needs, and they convinced me to make the company more important than my family. And I was shocked because I was thinking, okay, this is HRM, this is human, this is where we're supposed to care about humans, right? And I was signaling, I thought that this was not healthy for me, this was not, so that was a bit of an eye-opener for me, that even in human resource management, the people aren't the focus, it's a resource, it's not a person. So I applaud what you're doing there.
No, I got a question, but it is more about your business school than about your the course you are giving. Here, as you probably know, we are mixing humanistic subjects together with technical ones. Sometimes it's quite difficult to find the right dialogue between professors, professor of accounting with the professor of philosophy. Have you done something innovative or something different to integrate so different areas?
As a school or as a
university.
That's a good question. Within our that's an ongoing debate. So we are a university, so we have students are learning a universe of activities. It's not just a so when we design our curriculum, and it's probably every 7 years ago, the accountants say we need more accounting courses because that's what we need to be accredited, and other people say no, we need more sociology and psychology because we need more liberal arts. So that's an ongoing tension, I would say. Our school, compared to others, is probably a little bit more on the liberal arts side. I mean, we still have a voice there, and we're happy with that. But that's probably eroded in my time there. The one course that we've added that sort of reflects that a bit is the students are required to take a course in alternative management. So it's saying, we've got all our other management courses that are sort of mainstream, or that's what they end up being. We want at least one course where they're listening to a different kind of they're listening to only multi-stream using that language. So that's one way we've tried to, I don't know if it's humanism, but it's not just about money, there's other things we need to think about too. But one course isn't it's a good thing, I'm glad for it, but I would like to see all of our courses have more of it than they are. Like I showed you that accounting overhead. That I wrote that paper with an accounting professor from our school, and she liked it. She said, yeah, this is cool, two kinds of accounting. And you know, and I said, well, you should put that in your first year of your accounting courses and then build on it. She said, no, we'll put that in the last year. When and it's, no, if you're gonna do this, you have to flesh it out. You can't just throw it away at the last minute. But I mean, We've all been trained in our disciplines, right? We all know what mainstream is. That's our comfort zone. That's where we got our training in. And now to go outside that box is challenging. With regard to the second question, when I wrote that book, Management and the Gospel, I had support from my theology and biblical studies colleagues. I would have liked more. If one of them would have said, yeah, I'll co-author that with you, that would have saved me a lot of time. It would have probably been less fun. I'm glad I did it myself too. I mean, I learned a lot doing that. But theologians and biblical scholars and philosophers, they have their own shtick, right? When I started doing this on virtue theory, I went to a philosopher who I knew was into virtue theory and virtue ethics. And I said, I'm writing this book, I want to make virtue ethics, and I want to operationalize it in a textbook. How do you guys operationalize this? How do you make it work? And they said, we don't. We're philosophers, you know, we talk about these virtues, but how do you put it into practice? I don't know, have fun. So everybody has their own silos. So I found some who are willing to talk to me and work with, I mean, David Schrader, I have sort of a theology of management paper, and he's a theologian, and that was important for me to do that with him. But maybe you have more opportunities here, and that would be a strength if you did. Yep. That's a good question. No is a short answer, but I'll show you a slide in the next. I now have, you need permission and you need ethics reviews and stuff like that. So now the students that just graduated in December, I've asked permission so that I can contact them in 3 years and talk to them again. So I am starting to do that, but we haven't done that with this course per se, that's right.
So your current research is in the contrasting the multi-stream and the mainstream? Is that what you're trying to do now?
Yes. And that's, I mean, that's my the last part of my lecture is where it's going. I'm getting even more radical as I get older, I guess, is what it's going. The multi-stream world is the world where I'm having the most fun. That's where I think I have the most value to add. It's helpful for 500 million small-scale farmers. It's helpful for my students and what they want to be. And for me to do mainstream research, I do some of that too, but I concentrate my efforts on that.
For companies to be able to implement themselves multi-stream approach?
Very little. So when I started off as an academic, people would phone and say, Bruno, do you want to do consulting for our company? And they pay you money and it's a good thing. But I was more interested in doing interesting research than consulting. So when it sounds like an interesting company, then I will go and I will give them advice and stuff. But I haven't made that a big part of my career or my way of doing things. So if maybe there's other students who can become consultants or whatever, that's good.
But are you interested in creating some kind of multi-stream certificate or something like that?
Yes, that would be a wonderful idea. And I've talked to my students about that. And I mean, there are these different pledge of, what's it called? Harvard had one, and there's, you know, I'm going to march to the beat of a different drum kind of thing, and we talk about that as a class. But if there was a way of giving that some legs, that would be good. I mean, my father was an entrepreneur. There's still part of me that's an entrepreneur. I think doing the multi-stream is entrepreneurial, but there's still part of me, maybe I should start up a 100-mile restaurant or, you know, it's something that's tangible, that creates jobs, whatever, and play with that in my sandbox. But there's only so many hours a day. There's only so much fun a person can have, you know.
We talked yesterday about publications.
Yep.
And I explained to you how the accrediting and the typical university pressures to publish and so on. And the tension that we have here with the mission and the approach that we're trying to take. And I explained to you a little bit about the difficulty that our professors have trying to fit the credentials requirements with those who want to also support the mission of the university, or the rethinking process of education, which you are doing. So you perhaps you can talk a little bit about that and how you're at the University of Manitoba, which is a public university.
Correct.
It's a public university. This is not a private university. When he mentions theologians and philosophers,
don't think that it's a private university account. No, it's not. It's public. It is funded by the state, and they have, in some ways, similar publication pressures. They have to publish. Of course, they have. They are given time to research. Here we have a lot. The teaching loads are lower, but still, I think that some of what he's doing, like this book, is very much outside of the norm. You know, look at the picture. So can you talk about what advice would you give to someone who wants to publish in the business world from a different perspective and still be taken seriously in the business world?
Yeah.
Or in the business community?
Sure. First, a little story on that book. In Canada, we have something called the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada. So it's basically the government saying, we're going to give some money to research university professors for grants. And some of that money goes to business schools. And then you put in a proposal for a grant, and there's maybe 100 proposals, and 20 of them will get accepted. And they get sent into a group of finance professors and marketing professors and accounting professors, all in one group, and they'll read these 100 proposals, and then they choose one, or they choose 20, they rank them. So I propose that I'm going to look at the Gospel of Luke through a first century set of eyes and look at what it says about business. And I argue that the Protestant ethic is not necessarily the correct way of reading the biblical gospel. So I wrote that proposal, I sent it to this group of public professors who are teaching finance and accounting, and they rated it as one of their top proposals. So what I'm saying with that is, when you think of the biblical stuff, they all, that's just interested for Christians, and there's not many of those. The world is recognizing that there's a hunger for that sort of stuff. And Catholic social thought in particular, you have a forum that I think there's interest in that. So it's not that, it's still a trick and it's still, you know, a narrow span, but there's openness in some places. I don't know if that would work in Spain, probably not from what I've heard. So you need a journal that's friendly and that's on your list, and I haven't seen your list, but I'm guessing Journal of Business Ethics is on your list and Business and Society Review are on your list. From my experience, those are two good journals that would be interested in this sort of stuff. There's Journal of Management History that would be interested in this sort of stuff, I think, that where if you grounded it in a history kind of an idea. There's other journals that Business Ethics Quarterly maybe, but those are the journals that I think would be the easiest from my perspective to publish something that had CST, that had Catholic social thought there. There are Catholic journals, but I'm guessing those aren't on your list. In terms of subject matter, you have to do something that you're interested in. If you're just doing it to get published, that takes all the fun out of it. So something that you're passionate about. And what are the edges that you have that others don't have? So do you have particularly good access to your alumni? And you could do this kind of follow-up stuff. And you can get real managers to fill out forms. And that's very difficult to do, to get real sound. You know, there's a lot of research on students, but that's not real people. Maybe you have great access to real people, or maybe you have some very cool organizations. This business is marching to the beat of a different drum. We're going to go do a case study and talk about that. So I talked about community-supported agriculture. This was a small farm that had 200 sharers. I have two journal articles that focus on that, one in Leadership Quarterly and one in Journal of Organizational Change Management, I think. I forget where it was in, but those are mainstream good journals to get into. And I've used that in probably three or four other articles. So this quantum organizing, I have a section on shared agriculture or on economy of communion in there. So if you have case studies, that's a good thing. Anything longitudinal. So if you have data from 1 year, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 4 year, 5, that's the data allows you to get published almost. So it's not just your ideas, but hey, we've got the data to support that. So that takes time to set up, but if you're willing to invest those resources, that's good. I myself am a qualitative researcher, so I like to talk to people and find out what's happening. I do some stuff with surveys and stuff, but very little. It's more what's really going on. That's my interest. That's how I do things. And that takes more time in terms of getting publications. I don't know if your system allows for that, if they recognize, yeah, it takes twice as long to do a qualitative study than to do two surveys or whatever. Those are some opening volleys or some tips there that might be helpful. Ask me more questions or tell me what you're into, and I'm happy to be a sounding board there. Administrative Science Quarterly. Have you heard of Administrative Science Quarterly? It's probably the top journal. Well, Administrative Science Quarterly, Academy Management Journal, and Academy Management Review are the three top journals in business. Administrative Science Quarterly, we have a study on church splits. So when a congregation has a fight and two congregations get started, I guess Catholic, no, you guys have movements, or I don't know what you guys have. But that's a top journal looking at that subject matter. So there is ways of doing that, but it takes time, and it sounds like you guys don't have as much time as I do for research.
Bruno, just a question.
Yep.
Thank you very much. You know, I wrote this morning about management, Montessori management. What about, I want to ask you about your experience coaching a very important application. What's happened with the cultural barriers? I mean, many of the theories, many of the management, business management theories and applications comes from North countries, and but in this case, seems that multi-stream is based on model that is more horizontal than the cultural application and cultural problems that you can have in order to apply to this theory. What do you think about that? Do you see that is something that can be faster to be applied in these countries like Spain, for example? We are very creative, we are very we are not very constant in our business, but we are mostly small enterprises. And so there are very particular things in the different culture, the different countries that can be applied in this multi-system approach.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about that? Do you have experience about the different cultures, education different cultures?
When I first started writing my textbook, I did a scan of the whole world that I knew and said, show me a Spanish textbook that has to be translated into English, but that's written from a Spanish perspective, or from a Chinese perspective, or from a Japanese perspective, or a Taiwanese perspective, and I didn't find any. UK had something, that's about as far as I could get. Instead, when you go to these other countries, what you see is you have the same textbook as in the United States, except now it's the Southeast Asian version, or the, I don't know, do you have a Spanish version of English textbooks here? I don't know what you guys do here. So we have Canadianized version of US textbooks. So we have the US textbook, that's the gospel, that's real, and now we'll throw in some Canadian examples and we can use it here. So I was looking for this sort of endemic, you know, what is management like in different cultures? As a PhD student, I took a course in, well, it was a cultural anthropology, and there we looked at the Bushmen of the Kalahari, the Kung people. So this is 2,000 years old culture, and I wrote a paper on what was their management style. So what does management mean or organization mean in that context? In a way, that's what that book is doing. So I'm forcing myself into a different culture, but you know, have I done that specifically? No. But I was by making the mainstream and multi-stream, I was really hoping that it would create a space for an international audience where it says that the mainstream, that might be explain what's happening in the States or in North America or in Western developed countries or whatever, but there is a different way of doing things that's more true to Spain or more true to Ecuador or more true to Nigeria or whatever. And I think the multi-stream is more more timeless in that way. I think it does, but there's been this whole globalization movement and everything is becoming more mainstream, right? I'm not sure I'm answering your question. I think you can apply it, And I think it's probably, if Spain has a bunch of small creative organizations, my guess is Spain is already more multi-stream than Canada is, for that matter. But if you give them a language, and again, that's what we do. We provide students a language, right? Porter provided one language. What language are you providing? Are you just reinterpreting Porter, or are you providing a different language here, a different lens, a different framework? Let me build on that a little bit with my next part here. Whoops. And this is, how do we teach? And we're a university. We teach ideas. That's what we do. We say we want students to learn theory. There's knowledge. There's facts that we're going to teach them. And that's going to change their worldviews. That's going to change their way of thinking. We're going to teach them about dignity, and we're going to teach them about common good and subsidiarity, and we're going to teach them about multi-stream, and that's going to change the way they think about the world, I mean, who they are, and that's going to become then what they do in the future. That's usually how we think about education. So this is based on Harvard's no do, be do, and it's actually consistent with the Lucan journey that I have there in triple loop learning theory. So I told you we have this one course where we have an alternative management course. Everybody has to take this course. So we have two ways of teaching this course, different courses, but two ways of teaching it. One is this way here. So we teach them the theories, get them to read all these critiques of capitalism and stuff, and we hope that's going to get them to look outside of the box and maybe influence what kind of manager they are in the future. We did a study on those students. Have they changed from here to there? And the answer is no, they haven't. You can give them all the ideas in the world, but it doesn't really change them. What does change them? If we do some praxis in the course. So some of the sections had, this is a course on corporate social and environmental sustainability. So now I'm teaching this course, and basically I'm teaching only multi-stream, right? This is great. I don't have to worry about the mainstream stuff. I'm teaching only multi-stream, and I want them to become liberated and to be thinking outside of the box and to be critical thinking. So you'd think that this is the way to do it. I've got a whole course to give them this knowledge so that, but it doesn't work. What does work is if you put some praxis into the course. And praxis in my course is, we call it experiments with sustainability. So we say, you guys are university students. You know all about the problems in the world, about climate change and about income inequality and about recidivism rates and crime rates. And you know all these problems. Is it changing who you are? Are you living differently because you know it? No. So what I want you to do is choose something and do it for a week. I don't care what it is. So lots of students say, well, I'm going to use no fossil fuels for a week. I'm going to just go on my bike and go public transport or whatever. Other students say, well, I know that meat causes a lot of problems. I'm going to eat no meat. I'm going to be a vegetarian or a vegan for a week. Other students say, I'm going to go walk in the park for half an hour a day and meditate mindfully. I'm going to go volunteer for this agency. So they do these experiments with sustainability. So I say, go do something. Write it up, tell me what you learned, if you learned anything about it. And they hand them in, and it's a lot of grading, it's a lot of reading, but it's a wonderful reading, and they've changed. So we did research on that and said, these people become less materialistic, they become less individualistic, and they become more attuned to the new ecological paradigm. And this idea of praxis, so if those of you who are critical theory background, that's when critical theorists write about praxis, even pedagogically, it's an intellectual praxis. So we've got to get them thinking outside of the normal boxes. I don't think thinking outside our normal boxes is enough. You've got to get them doing something. And that's, again, consistent with the Lucan metaphor, with the Lucan four-phase learning model, too. So that's the praxis. So that's my challenge. This is a paper we're working on right now. That's my challenge for you pedagogically. That surprise you?
No.
No?
No, I think I have that experience in my teaching. It's not that easy to get that doing.
Yeah. So the way I do the doing, actually, more and more, the longer, Now, if you were in my course and this was the first class, I'd say, you are going to design the course outline for this course. And I have eye clickers, and we have a bunch of questions. How many exams do you want? Do you want two tests or three tests? Do you want to do an experiment with doing, or do you want to go interview a manager, or do you want to do this, or do you want to do that? And then the students choose, and they design the course. And the first time I offered that, they weren't very keen, to be honest. And I said, let's do it as an experiment. I encouraged them. But after that first group, they loved it. So now students are coming, we want to do this. This is cool. This is fun. We're actually doing something, and it's such a breath of fresh air compared to all these other things we just have to read and reread. Yep.
Yeah, we are blessed in this university because we have an activity which is transversal, and all the students have to make it. It's initially it's compulsory because they give credits for that, which is social action. That means that they have to deploy time, a certain amount of hours in a year, helping others, and they have a big menu, a long list of different institutions and agencies that they can serve.
Okay.
And that really changes them a lot because they discover the capacity they have to help others and how valuable they are, and also to understand that there are other people that are not that privileged as they are. So I take profit of that, and that part of the doing that is done previously to my course, but I refresh the memory and I bring them to presence what they felt and what they experienced when doing those things, which is basically integrating, in fact, another kind of sustainability, which is integrating others, races or people, disabled people, into the market, or the business environment.
So you have a natural experiment that you could do here. You could talk to students when they come in, and you could give them a questionnaire about materialism and individualism. Where are they? Then you could have them do their practicum or whatever it's called, and have them do that experiment again. Have they changed? And then you could do it in your course and say, now I'm going to do a mini thing in my course, and have them do it again. So do their views for management change, or do their views of life change here, or do their views of management and life change here? That would be an interesting study that you could do, and it would probably be relatively easy to do. I don't know. Thank you. Okay, other questions on this? I have one more part that's sort of where Bruno's going in the future, but if we want a workshop or if we want to do something else, that's fine too.